Good morning, Liberty Church, and good morning to everybody watching this from all over the world. My name is Pastor Mark Ritchie, and this is my dog, Cotton. Yeah. Now, lots of you have been complaining you haven't seen Cotton so much these last few weeks. So just to make sure she's not left out, I just thought we'd give her a little performance at the start. Hey, Cotton. Say hello, everybody. I prophesy she's going to start barking in the next 2 minutes. Okay, I'm going to put her down here. Okay. How you all doing? It's the last weekend of November. Can't believe it. And I've got to make a confession. Our Christmas tree and our decorations are already up. Whoa, never thought I'd see the day. I'm gonna ask you a very serious question right now. How many of you, your Christmas trees are up? Lift your hands. 67%, unbelievable. Times are changing. And part of the reason why people are putting up their trees is because it's been such a hard year. Why not try and celebrate Christmas early? But like I said to you, in the Philippines, it's September 1st you start celebrating Christmas. So we're a long, 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 long way behind. But never mind. Today, I'm really believing that God is going to speak into your lives. And God has been speaking into my life this week. And I want to share what he's been saying. It's very important. Who we look at in this season, where our eyes are in this season. And I'm going to be talking later on about how we shouldn't look behind. It's funny because, you know what I mean? I've been talking about remembering. Remembering's great. And looking back is great. But many people live in the past. They live in the past, especially in the season when we've got so many things happening. And if only it was like this. Remember when we can do this. Oh, remember when we... And you know what? It's so easy to get frustrated and down and sad as we look behind. And so I'm going to be encouraging us today to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. He's got a plan, a purpose, a dream, a vision for our lives. And although right now we can't fully understand it, he is going to come through. I honestly believe something great is going to happen in my life, in my family, in my church, in this city, in this nation. Something is going to happen. Let's just keep faithful, keep our eyes fixed on him, because he is going to do something great. Today, we've got a really bright time of worship from the worship team. Rachel's got an amazing, super amazing kids time. I know it. I've experienced a little bit of it. I know what's coming. Get your kids ready. It's going to be absolutely brilliant. Di Woolridge is going to do a spoken truth. He is absolutely amazing. I'll tell you more about Sound of Wales later. And then I've got a message God's been speaking to me about where we look, where our eyes are. And I pray that God will really, really speak to you. So I don't know what you're going through or what you've been through. But this song says, God, I look to you. You're where my strength comes from. And I just pray that today as you worship, I just want to encourage you. As the worship team are leading us in worship, they're not just singing on screen. They're leading us in worship. So why don't you stand up or do something to show the Lord that you're also worshiping. Lift your hands to him and give him all the praise and glory and honor. Are you ready? Fasten your seatbelts. And I'm telling you, by the end of this service, you are going to be challenged because the Lord has challenged me. God bless you all. Cotton's gone now, but the Holy Spirit's here. So just rise to your feet right now. Come on, worship team, lead us in worship. We thank God for every one of you. Our God reigns. Amen. Come on, let's have a wonderful morning.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. fly by night, a guiding light to my feet. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through.
Sing to the God of the ages. Sing.
the moment of rescue. I have never been the same when his love took me captive and my sin was washed away. Now I stand here forgiven, and I know that I am saved, and I won't be put to shame. Remember how our God has never failed, never failed us. Remember that his name will make a way, he'll make a way. From the cross to the grave, he is risen and he reigns. Praise the Lord, sing his praise again.
Good, and I know you hold
my future and my hope. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail.
Healing.
Healing, freedom, as you speak favor over me. Faith is breaking all impossibilities. Your name has overcome, your name alone. For I know your thoughts, your plans for me are good. And I know you hold my future in hope. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail.
I am standing on every promise that you make. I will see it come to pass in your name, in your name. Oh, Jesus, I will trust every word I hear you say. I will see it come to pass in your name, in your name. I am standing on every promise that you make. I will see it come to pass in your name, in your name. Oh, Jesus, I will trust every word I hear you say. Plans for me are good, and I know you hold my future and my hope. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail.
We have been learning about being battle ready. Are you guys battle ready? Come on, let me see you. Woo! Say ready! Ready! Are you battle ready? Ready! So we've been learning about how God tells us in the Bible to put on the whole armor of God so that we'll be able to stand against the enemy. All right, now we learned the first week about putting on our belt of truth. Remember that? Stop those things flapping around. And then last week, Dave spoke to us about body armor and how he was ready to run into battle because his organs and everything was protected. Well, today we are learning about our shoes, having the right shoes on. The Bible tells us to put on the shoes of peace, the preparation of the gospel of peace, special shoes of peace. And so my question to you is, are you wearing the right shoes?
Hey, girls.
Hi, we're going hiking.
Oh, wow.
Okay, Liberty kids, we are playing badminton.
Who thinks Mr. Dave can beat Pastor Mark?
Who thinks I can beat that guy over there?
No way, here we go. Come on, Mark.
I'll put some spin in it.
Yep. I think this is the wrong shoes for playing badminton. What do you think?
Ready? action. Did that work?
Well, hello there. Hi, Liberty Kids. I'm out here doing some gardening. Just cutting the hedge, kiddos. Yes.
Yeah, missed it. There we go.
I got him.
Yeah. Just living my best life. With some shears. Yeah. My completely appropriate attire for the task at hand. Just trimming away. Yeah. Normally, Dad would be doing this, but his snowshoes are in the shop.
Hi there, Liberty Kids. I didn't see you there. Today, I'm trimming a hedge with these cutters.
Hi, Liberty Kids. I'm just here playing some tennis.
Now, in Australia, we don't wear shoes an awful lot because it's very hot. And I'll tell you a story about when we moved to Queensland, which is a hot place in Australia, and we had to shift schools because we shifted again. So my brothers, they were about to go to a school called Budrum Primary School. And my mum took them up to the school and was checking out the uniform. Well, I think they had to wear like a burgundy, like polo shirt and just maybe some gray shorts or something. And mum said to the head teacher, "What about shoes?" Now, my mum's question was, do they have to wear like black leather school shoes or can they just wear any sort of trainers, that sort of thing? But you know what the teacher said? The head teacher said, "Oh, yes, please. We really are trying to encourage the kids to wear shoes. That would be great." Encourage the kids to wear shoes. Can you believe it? There were heaps of kids that actually never wore shoes to school. We hadn't come across that before. But once we moved to Queensland, oh my goodness, these kids went barefoot to school. How crazy is that? And you know, when you grow up living like that, your feet actually get really tough on the bottom and you don't notice when you're walking over stones. Now, I didn't notice. I didn't know anything about it. I didn't know that I had Aussie feet until one day when Dave had come to Australia to visit before we got married. We were walking along the stones at the top of the car park, heading down to the beach. And I was just walking barefoot, no worries at all. And the ground, it was hot and there were stones and it was summer. And anyway, I was just walking along, heading down the beach, and I turned around and Dave is walking along behind me. And that was when I learned something. There is such a condition as British feet. You guys might even have it. If I'm honest, I maybe have it now too. But what happens is our feet feel things. They're quite soft because we're not used to walking on the heat and hot ground and over all the stones and the bumpy things. Do you know that the ground gets so hot in Australia that Dave used to wear leather shoes when he was working in a car yard? And one day, the tarmac was so hot where he was working that the bottom of his shoes started to melt to the ground. How crazy is that? His shoes were getting sticky on the ground because his shoes were melting from the heat on the tarmac. That is crazy, huh? So when you're doing things like this, when you're going to the beach, when you're working in hot places, actually, no matter what we're doing, it's important that we have the right shoes. Now, in Roman times, they had different sorts of weapons, different sorts of strategies of fighting. And one of the things that they were doing in that time is they were laying sharp objects in the ground. The opposition would just put sharp things in the ground so that if you didn't have the right shoes on, you'd start to run across the ground and oh, you'd get maybe a big bit of glass or a sharp bit of metal stuck in your foot. And you can't keep marching then. You can't keep going then if you're in a battle, can you? What you've got on your feet is actually really, 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 really important. And so, in this Bible verse, where God's telling us to put on the whole armor of God so that we can stand against the enemy, he's telling us to put the right shoes on. And he tells us that the right shoes are the shoes of peace. Now, I want to read a Bible verse to you. In Romans chapter 5, verse 1, it says, "Therefore, since we've been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ has done for us." Now, what does that mean? Therefore, since we've been made right with God. You see, when we believe in Jesus, when we say, "Jesus, I know that you died for me. I receive you as my Savior. I love you. I'm going to live for you. I give you my life and I receive that forgiveness." You know, when we give our life to Jesus, when we become a Christian, when we belong to his family, it says that the peace of God is given to us. And that beautiful peace is that we don't have to worry anymore. We don't have to worry, is God really for me? Does God really love me? Has God really forgiven me? Is God really here with me when I'm going through the battle? And when we put on these shoes of peace, it happens when we say, "Yes, Jesus, I'm yours." And he said, "Here's the shoes of peace. Everywhere you go, you are going to know that you can go there confidently in peace because you're mine and I'm yours and I go with you." Now, these shoes of peace, we don't have to worry because we belong to God. No matter what the enemy throws at us, it's like, "I've got peace. I've got peace. I belong to God. I've got my right shoes on." And it doesn't matter what happens, what circumstances are going on around us. It doesn't matter what bombs the enemy's throwing in. He might be just like throwing some things in and hitting us in the side of the head saying, "God's not gonna listen to you." But it's like, come on, I've got the shoes. I've got peace with God. I'm at peace, and so I am ready for anything that gets thrown my way. You know what? These peace shoes, they change everything. And here's another thing. You know, when we go places, everyone brings peace. Sometimes when we arrive, we bring peace. And everyone's like, "Oh, I'm so glad you're here." Who's got one of those friends? It's like when they arrive, or maybe it's your mum, when she gets there, it's like, "Oh, I'm so glad she's here." And it's like peace comes. And then there's some people when it's like, "Oh, I'm so glad they're gone." And it's like you can relax because they're gone. It was maybe really stressful when they were there. Or, you know, we all bring peace one way or another. Sometimes when we arrive and sometimes when we leave. But you know what? When we carry the peace of Jesus, people love it when we arrive. It's like you're different. When you're here, you bring something. You've just got, "Wow, I just love being around you. I can't even put it into words. There's something different about you." And so I just want you to look down and have a look at what shoes are you wearing today? Have you got peace with God? Have you made your peace with him? Have you said, "Yes, God, I belong to you, and we've settled that forever. I'm yours." And if you have, you can know that you have got the shoes of peace, that everywhere you go in peace. And if you don't, all you have to do is ask him. You just have to turn to him and say, "God, I want to live for you. I want you to be my savior. I want you to be my Lord. I want you to be my dad. I want to be forgiven. God, I want peace with you today. I don't want anything to stand between us. God, I take those shoes of peace today." And if you've never done that and you're just wondering if you have peace with God, let's just pray that together now, okay? Oh God, we just come to you and we give you our lives today. We say, "God, we're so sorry for the times we've walked our own way. We're so sorry for the decisions that we've made that have been stupid. We're so sorry for trusting in ourselves. And We know that you love us. We know that you sent Jesus to die for us. We know that you have good plans for us. And so today we turn our hearts to you and we say, God, we give you our lives. And we ask you just to forgive us and to come and live with us. Come and live in our hearts, Lord. God, I ask that you would give us your peace today. Lord, that we would stand with the right shoes on today, the shoes of peace, the shoes of assurance, that no matter where we go, no matter what happens, we're wearing those right shoes. God, I just pray for each young person listening now. I just pray that they would know your overwhelming sense of peace today, that they are wearing the right shoes, and that they are battle ready. I just ask that in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Have a great week, guys. See you next week. Bye. Hey, Liberty Kids. It is a ripper of a day down here in Swansea, and I am just heading out for a swim. See you guys.
Your wellies are full of water. What's that?
I don't think these are the right shoes. Oh. See you later, kids.
Should you pray for the kids, babe?
Every day.
Rachel, that was absolutely brilliant. That took a lot of effort, a lot of planning, some superstar acting by me and Dave. Did you notice that I won the point there against Dave at badminton? I won't hold it against him, but you know, I usually beat them anyway. Oh, anyway, brilliant. Rachel, thank you so much. Yeah, it's so, so true. We wear the right footwear. Amen. So great. Okay, some announcements. Praise the Lord, we bought some of the equipment that we need for our church. And next week we're going to be starting putting it all together. Really, really exciting, really good. Jack and the team are doing a great job there. It's brilliant. Thank you all, also those who give faithfully every week or every month to Liberty Church. We are just so grateful. We don't take it for granted, and we are so blessed that we can actually, you know, still do what God wants us to do. Just to let you know, we've moved out of the church house, and now we're going to be handing the keys back on Wednesday, and we're going to have our office in the church building. It was just more of a stewardship thing. We've hardly used the house in 8 months, and who knows when we can use it again. So that's what we've done. We've made a decision, and it's a good decision, and we're going to be in the church hall. Pray for heat during the winter. Amen. So that's great. We're moved. So thanks to Dave especially. He's done so much, Dave McClay, in moving the stuff, and we really appreciate that. Okay, so I wanted to encourage you to come to Zoom. After the service, we've got Zoom again, and it's going to be so good. We're excited just to see each other and to share with each other and to have a blether, have a little talk. Thank you. Please, I want to encourage you to join us for Zoom after the service. Big groups are continuing, and some new ones are starting this week. It's so exciting, and I just want to encourage you. If you don't know if you're in a big group, let us know, and we'll put you in one, because I feel it's so important. Again, we're doing more and more in terms of prayer. Tuesday morning, Friday mornings, Thursday nights, 10 o'clock. I want to encourage you to come and seek the face of the Lord together. I really believe that we are being called into a season of prayer. And I know that that's where the power is going to come from. So please have a look and see and join us for our times of prayer. And that is absolutely brilliant. Now I'm going to ask Di Woolridge to come and do a spoken word or spoken truth. Di Woolridge is part of Sound of Wales. He's married to the amazing Kath Woolridge. And I want to put this in here, one, because it's a brilliant piece, and two, I want to really encourage you to look up Sound of Wales on YouTube and subscribe. And they've been doing some amazing stuff recently. Sound of Wales Creative, I know that Etienne and Dave from our church is really involved in that. And I want to really get behind this amazing ministry. And I want you to go there, subscribe, listen to the songs, listen to some of the spoken truths that Di's got. It's just amazing, just some stuff about worship. It's really a brilliant, brilliant YouTube page and also website. Go there and be absolutely blessed. I'm continually blessed by Kath and the team and what they're doing. And so usually we'd have them in Liberty Church at Christmas time, but we can't do it this year. But we bless them and we love them. And Di's going to come and do a spoken truth with us. After that, the worship team's got a song, and I'm going to come straight in with the Word of God. So over to you, Di. Everybody, support Sound of Wales. We love them.
How would we look and be if we actually believed that Christ Almighty rescued you and liberated me? What would be our reality? If we fully realized that He's changed our eternal destiny, that what was our verdict no longer has to be, that though the fall brought catastrophe, Christ Jesus paid our penalty, His resurrection set us free from the curse of sin. And so He brings us in to love, forgiveness, acceptance, and community. He adopts us into His family. How would we look and be if we recognize with clarity that though Christ ascended, His Spirit now lives and dwells in me? And if you've chosen Jesus, He lives in you too. It's true. But He didn't fill us with His Spirit to stay in the upper room. He fills us to step up and step out, to rise up and reach out, to plead for the needs of the down and out, to pray to the one who radically makes the change that counts, to be gospel participators, not just pacifists. Together we pitch in, get stuck in, to see His kingdom enter in, to pray for freedom where there is none, to be on the front line to see His will be done, to bring hope to the hopeless, to bring light where there's darkness, to see freedom from addictions, to believe in healing from afflictions, to ask the broken people make believe the decisions. May we see His power unleashed, His ministry unleashed. May we see the grip of sin, the shackles released. And may we church be unleashed to be His hands and His feet, together unleashed, in the pews and pulpits, but also on the streets. Not just the places on the strategic planning sheets, everywhere unleashed, to see bearers of burdens of baggage set free, to see His gospel radically impact our community. But not in our strength, His. Not our will, His. Not our spirit, His Spirit. Holy Spirit, the one who intercedes for us, the one who lives and dwells in us. For Your glory, God, fill us.
All over my life.
strength, and you always will be. I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life.
I read for God's word this morning. I believe that as God's been speaking to me, he's also going to speak to you, and that you are going to be challenged just like I've been challenged. We live in incredible days, and just for me personally, I don't think I've ever been closer to the Lord. I don't think I've ever heard so clearly from the Lord. And in these days, I'm saying, God, above every other voice, above all the noise, above all the media, I want to hear your voice. I want to hear your heart. I want you to speak to me clearly. Holy Spirit, I eagerly desire the spiritual gifts that I need to see your kingdom extended here in Swansea. And God's been speaking to me this week about something really, really great. This week has been absolutely brilliant. As a dad, I am so proud. Because you know why? Lydia passed a driving test. Woohoo! I should have got the Oh, I should have done all that, but anyway, I didn't do it. Lydia passed a driving test. And you know what? She went away on Monday morning. We were so nervous. Me and Mary, we were trying to pray. We prayed and prayed and prayed. Lord, please, please help her, help her. Because she's a brilliant driver. Lydia is, even from day one, I said, Lydia, no problem. You got no problem with confidence. You got no problem with, you are a brilliant driver. And you know, the only thing that I thought might be a little bit of a problem is that sometimes when I'm taking Lydia out, and we've done, I don't know how many hours, 50, 60 hours, you know, sometimes I see her looking in her rear view mirror, and sometimes she gets distracted and she thinks that people are too close to her, and she takes it kind of personally. Why is she doing that? Why is she so close to me? He could have rammed me. And sometimes, you know, she's so busy looking in the, one time we're in Clonechley, we're coming up the roundabout, it wasn't busy, but there's a guy right up behind her, and I'm saying, Lydia, forget it, look out the front, don't worry about him. He's got his own driving to think about. Oh, no, Dad, he's coming up right behind me. And she was so concerned that this guy in the rear view mirror, that when we came to the roundabout, oh, Dad, where am I going? I said, straight ahead. And she went, I said, see, Lydia, you're so busy checking out that guy in the rear view mirror, how close he was to you. And you're saying that, you know, maybe he's not caring about me. He's going to go in the back of me. You're so worried about this guy behind you. In reality, he doesn't know who you are. He's not trying to spoil your night. He's maybe a little bit too close, but it's up to him. If he bangs into you, it's his problem. That's the law of the UK. Don't look at your rear view mirror. You missed the roundabout almost. Oh, Dad, yeah, you're right. And so when she went to her test, I'm thinking, Lord, please don't let anybody come. I even thought about getting in my car and like following her around, keeping about 30 feet just to make sure nobody got in there. But no, it was fine. And she passed her test. And God's been really speaking to me about this, you know. You cannot go forward if you're always looking behind. Nobody can drive a car by just looking in the rear view mirror. If you look only in the rear view mirror, you see what's behind you, but you don't really see. It's a blur. Your windscreen at the front, it's a blur. You can't concentrate on the front if you're looking behind. And God's been speaking into my life this week about not looking back. Now, I said to you already, that's really weird, Mark, because you're talking about remembering. But I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about living in the past, looking back to the past. You know, it's good to remember. But if we constantly look back at the past, the good, the bad, and the ugly in our lives, that can rob us for what God wants to do in our lives today. So many people are robbed for living for Jesus today because all they're doing is looking in the rearview mirror, looking behind, the way it used to be, the way we used to worship, the things we used to do. And they're always living in the past, and they're living the past so much that they cannot possibly move on in God because they're always looking in the rearview mirror. People talk about revival and, you know, what happened in 1904 and Lucker, and it's absolutely fantastic. But I'm telling you right now, this next move of God that we're going to have is going to look nothing like the revival of 1904. Society's changed. People have changed. You know, the world has changed. And so God is more modern than tomorrow's newspaper. He's got ways that are incredible. The same message, but in different ways. But people want it to be the same way, the same songs. Sometimes I sing, Here is Love Vast as the Ocean. And I'm thinking, is this like a calling card for revival? It doesn't work like that. God's got a new song. He's got a new song for Wales. I believe it. You know, and what's going to happen these next few years is nothing going to like that what happened in 1904. Some things are the same. The prayer is the same. The hunger is the same. The desperation is the same. The belief is the same. But the way God's going to do it is different. But you see, if we're always looking in the rear view mirror, 1904, you know, Lucher, 1949, the Hebrides, if we always look in the rear view, we can learn from what happened there, but let's not live there. And let's not stop what happened then, stop what God wants to do right now. And so there are actually dangers in looking behind or looking back. What are some of these dangers? Four things. One, don't look back at what you had. Don't look back at what you had. There's an incredible story in the Bible, and you know what I'm going to say here, about Sodom and Gomorrah. We know what happened. Lot and Abraham decided to separate, and Abraham said, where do you want to go? And Lot saw this beautiful city, Sodom, Gomorrah. I want to go there. That's where I can bring up my family. That's where the people are. That's where the market is. That's where I can find water. That's where I can find food. That's a good place. Yay, Sodom, Gomorrah. And so he chose the beautiful plains of Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham said, well, okay, I'll just go to the wilderness, to the desert. And God said to him, don't worry, Abraham. Have a little look around. Wherever you see, it's yours. It's yours. But you know what happened? Lot and his family went to Sodom and Gomorrah. Sodom was a terrible, terrible place. God sent two angels in there to Sodom and Gomorrah. He stayed with Lot's family. And at that night, the men, young men, middle-aged men, old men, they went to Lot's house and said, send out those two men. We want to have sex with these two men. I mean, how perverse was it? They were so perverse. And so the way they thought and the things, they wanted to kill these men as well. And they had really bad tempers and violent. And so what happened was the angel said to Lot, tell you and your family and any relatives you've got, God is going to destroy this city. You need to leave here. And we know what happened. So Lot gets his family together, his wife, his kids, his own family, his nephews, his nieces. Some people didn't believe what was going to happen. And this is what Jesus said about the situation. And the world will be as it was in the days of Lot. People went about their daily business, eating and drinking, buying and selling, farming and building, until the morning that Lot left Sodom. Then fire and burning sulfur rained down from heaven and destroyed all of them. Yes, it will be business as usual, right up to the day when the Son of Man is being revealed. On that day, a person out on the deck of a roof must not go down to the house to pack. A person out in the field must not return home. Remember what happened to Lot's wife. If you cling to your life, you will lose it. If you let go of your life, you will save it. That night, two people will be asleep in one bed. One will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding flour together in the mill. One will be taken and the other one left. Remember Lot's wife. What happened to Lot's wife? Well, they ran from Sodom and Gomorrah, or Sodom, and they had all their belongings that they could carry, and they could hear the screams, they could see the fire and the brimstone coming down, they could see the city being destroyed, and Lot says, don't look back, just keep on going, keep on going, keep on going. But what did Lot's wife do? She couldn't help but to see. The Bible talks about it. She looked back and saw, wanted to see her home, wanted to see the things that she'd left. One more look at what I had. And immediately she was turned into salt. Wow. Don't look back at what you had. You know, sometimes in our lives, it's easy to look back to what we had. Sometimes in our lives, there have been better days. Maybe financially, we used to be a bit stronger. Maybe medically, we used to be a bit stronger. We can look back at things that we had. Maybe in the past, we had a nicer car or a nicer house. Now, because of, you know, economics and stuff, we've downgraded a little bit. And it's easy to look back at what we had in the past. And sometimes you can say, well, you know, wow, you know, it was much better back then. And you look back and you yearn, if only I could have that. If only I still had that. And, you know, it's so easy to do that, especially in times of difficulty like we're in right now. But the Bible says this, that the world and its desires pass away, but the man who does the will of God will reign forever. And Jesus said this in Matthew 6, don't store up here on earth. Don't store up treasures here on earth where moths eat them and rust destroys them, where thieves break in and steal, but store up your treasures in heaven where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. Wherever your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Don't build up treasures here on earth, but build up treasures in heaven. And so many people are trying to build up treasures here on earth. And, you know, they're trying to build up a fantastic life and lifestyle and stuff. And they spend all their time and all their energy and all their focus trying to get more, to earn more, to have more. And Jesus said, don't spend your lives trying to gather things that are imperishable. But look. Perishable, sorry. But look and build up treasures in heaven that are imperishable. You know, what you do in your life, you know, for the Lord is never wasted. I remember a guy called Brian Bailey, and the Lord gave him a vision, and the Lord said that everything that we do in our lives, the Lord notices. Even if it's just a smile, even if it's just a text, even if it's just an encouragement, even if it's whatever it is, nothing, everything is counted. And in my life, I want to build up. Don't get me wrong, I want my family to have everything that they need. I want my family to provide for them. But I want my focus to be the kingdom of God. I want to build up treasures in heaven. One day, God gave me a dream. And we used to live in Edinburgh. I used to live in Edinburgh after I left Bible college. I went to Edinburgh, and we started a church there, and there was a lovely couple who was there, Jeff and Vicky. Oh, they were really lovely. He had his own business. And you know, what happened was that Jeff and Vicky once had a beautiful house. I don't know where it was, but they once had a beautiful house, because you know what? Vicky was always telling us about the house that she used to have, you know, and even I went there a few times to their new house, and it was lovely. It was big. It was beautiful. But she would always talk about her old house. Oh, her old house. It was beautiful. So many bedrooms. It was, wow, beautiful. And, every time you went to her old, new house, she was talking about the old house. And I could see that she loved. But because of, you know, the ministry and because of different things, that Jeff was, they decided to downgrade. But she always talked about her old house. And one day, this is years later, God gave me a dream. And I dreamt that I was in heaven. And in heaven, you know, there's people there in front of me in the queue. And God was saying to them, well done, good, faithful servant. And he was giving them these beautiful mansions, gold, sparkling, lovely. Well done, good. And the next one, well done, good, faithful servant. You have the reward of your life. And these beautiful, huge, beautiful mansions was absolutely great. And in front of me was Vicky. And I thought, wow, it's interesting. So Vicky was there, and the Lord came over and said, Vicky, I know what you love. I'll give you the desires of your heart. Oh, what is it, Lord? What is it? How is she going to give me? And he walked around the corner, and here was our old house from Edinburgh, surrounded by these gold mansions, were absolutely incredible. And this house, even though it was beautiful in Edinburgh, just looked so bad, surrounded by what the Lord was giving out. And then I woke up and I started to laugh because you know what we really cherish and run for and focus on down here. One day we're going to be in heaven. We can pick up a piece of gold. It's a piece of gold. You know, we're going to a place where, the Bible describes heaven as a place of absolute beauty. You know what? We're not going to be thinking about houses up there or, we're going to be thinking about Jesus, worshiping Jesus. So I want to encourage you, don't look back at what you had. If there's a time in your life that you used to have a lot of things, thank the Lord for that. But just be grateful for what you have now. Amen? Number two, don't look back and make excuses. Jesus tells a story in Luke chapter 9 about the cost of following him. And he talks about people that he's spoken to. I don't know if it's a parable or if it's real people. And he says this, as they were walking along, someone said to Jesus, I will follow you wherever you go. Man, it's so easy to talk, isn't it? But Jesus replied, foxes have dens to live in, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. He said to another person, come, follow me. The man agreed, but he said, well, Lord, first let me go home and bury my father. And Jesus told him, let the spiritually dead bury their own dead. Your duty is to go and preach about the kingdom of God. Yes, Lord, said another one. I will follow you. But first, let me just go and say goodbye to my family. And Jesus told him, listen to this. This seems so hard. This is what Jesus said. Anyone who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. What a verse. Anybody who puts a hand to the plow, who starts off serving the Lord, who starts off walking with the Lord, who starts off, you know, doing something for the Lord and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. Wow, this is a challenging verse for all of us. Because these things were legitimate things. Bury my father, you know, I'm going to say goodbye to my family. You know, all these things. It's like the excuses people made not to come to the banquet, you know. And Jesus is saying, look, you know, these things are okay. But first of all, above everything else, love the Lord your God with all your heart. Do what he wants you to do. You know, establish his kingdom. Work for the Lord. Preach the kingdom of God. You know, and all these things will be added unto you. Anybody who looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. And you know what? In my life, there's times I've also made excuses. There's times in my life where, you know, yeah, Lord, I hear your voice. I know what you want me to do. But, you know, right now it's just maybe not the right time because blah, 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 blah. And we all make excuses. Moses made excuses to God. I mean, here's Moses. Can you imagine? Brought up, we all know the story, how the princess found him in the bulrushes and how he was brought up in Pharaoh's palace, the most powerful home in the whole world. He's brought up there. He was the best teacher. It says he spoke so beautifully. You know, and he was loved by everybody. And yet we know that he went out and he saw an Egyptian and an Israelite who were fighting, and he killed the Egyptian. And then he was a wanted man, and he ran away for 40 years. He ended up being a shepherd in the backside of the desert. And then we see the burning bush, and God says, I'm not finished with you yet, Moses. I've got a plan. And we know that God call them back to Egypt. He said, I've heard the cries of my people. I've seen their tears. I've seen their situation. And I'm sending you back, Moses. What? Me? Moses? Shepherd? Stutterer? I've been talking to sheep for 40 years. I'm a murderer. I'm a nobody. You're sending me back. And then we see a very interesting dialogue between Moses and God. And Moses makes four excuses. First of all, he says this, who am I? How can you expect me to lead these people? It was a matter of inferiority. He felt inferior. He's a nobody. He's a nothing. How am I going to do it? And God said to him, my presence will be with you. I'll go with you, Moses. I know what you think about yourself, but I will go with you. Okay, second excuse. They won't believe me. It was a matter of personality. Pharaoh's not going to believe me. You know, the Egyptians, even the Israelites are not going to believe me. And then God says, just tell them that I am is with you. I'll be there with you. I'll provide the miracles. I'll provide the power and the strength that you need. You know, I will be your guide. I will be the one that is with you. Don't worry what you feel about yourself. I am is with you. But Lord, they'll think I'm lying. It's a matter of integrity. And then God said, what's in your hand? Just a staff. I'm a shepherd. And God used, he said, I'm going to use that staff to show my glory and my power. And then the fourth and final excuse is, I'm not a good speaker. I'm a bit of a stammerer, a stutterer. And how am I meant to lead a whole nation when I can't hardly raise my voice? And you know, remember, he was noted for being one of the most incredible speakers in Egypt. Isn't it interesting how the enemy robs from you? Maybe there's some things in your life the enemy's robbed from you. It's time to say no more. It's time to go into the destiny of God. And so God said, don't worry, I'll put the words in your mouth and I'll send Aaron to help you. And so every excuse that he made, God said, I don't care about your excuse. I've got the answer. And you know, like I say, we can all make excuses. Are you really fully serving the Lord? Are you happy with your walk with God? Are you doing what he wants you to do and being the man or the woman that he wants you to be? Because we can make lots of excuses about it's not the right time, or when I'm finished my studies, I'll do it, or when my kids are up, I'll do it, or when this happens, I'll serve you, when this happens, I'll give, when I get enough money, I'm going to give so much to the church or to mission. We're always full of excuses. But I want to ask you, are you fully serving the Lord? I've told you maybe this story. When I was 18 years old, I had a real encounter with God when I was 17, became the youth leader in Fraserburgh, and I felt God might be calling me to to Bible college. I went to this prayer meeting and I went in there. There's about 20 people there. The average age was about 76. That's because I was there, 18. But I remember really troubled. You know, God, do you really want to call me to Bible college? I'm happy here. I love Fraserburgh. I love this church. You know, I love who I am, the job I've got. I love my family. I don't want to. And I made this prayer, Lord, I don't really know if you're calling me to Bible college. Number one, Lord, I don't have the money. Number two, Lord, I don't feel I'm a preacher. Number three, I feel inadequate. You know, I just don't feel I can do it. And, you know, I had four or five things that I said. And then the minute I just closed, the minute I stopped, this old man, Eric Martin, stood up. Yea, the Lord would say unto thee, he knows how you feel about yourself. He knows that you feel you can't speak, but the Lord will give you the words to say. He will train you in his ways. He knows you've got no finances. He will provide everything that you need. He knows that you feel weak and you can't do it. He will be your strength. Whatever you do today, pledge to the Lord your heart and say, Lord, what you've called me to do, I'll do it. I was shaken. It's like having a conversation with God. And I just felt that night, whatever excuse I put up, the Lord has an answer. And so that night, I went home and I poked my head through the bedroom door. Late at night, Mum and Dad were in bed. I said, Mum and Dad, I want to tell you, I'm going to Bible college. And I went into my room and just like, oh, look, I've said it now, said it now, said it now. And that was the night that I decided to really serve the Lord. But you know what? In the last, I don't know how many years ago that was, 31 years, I can't remember. Since that time, there's been times in my life where God has challenged me to do things and to go places. And sometimes the excuses come up and again, God says, I will be your guide. I will be your strength. I will be your rock. I will be your, I will be everything that you need to be. If I've called you to do it, I will equip you and make a way. But guys, let's not look back and make excuses. But decide to serve the Lord with all of our heart. Third thing, don't look back and remember your mistakes and disappointments. Wow, this is a big one. I know so many Christians, when they look back, they see the mistakes that they've made, the wrong choices that they've made. They see the disappointments along the way. And they look back at all those things and it hurts so much that they actually feel, I don't want to become vulnerable again. Because of all those mistakes, because of all those disappointments, because I maybe made the wrong move, I just don't trust myself. And I know so many Christians that they are absolutely stuck because all they do is look behind and see the mistakes and the disappointments that they've made. Peter, you know, we know Peter, who followed the Lord, who loved the Lord, who was there for 3 years, who passionately loved Jesus. But we know at the very end, when Jesus was dying on the cross, he blasphemed the name of the Lord. He cursed the name of the Lord. When the cock crowed 3 times, he realized what he'd done. And he looked at the cross. He wept bitterly. He went back to the fish and he thought, it's over. There's no way that God can use me. It's finished. And he heard that Jesus rose again and he ran to the tomb. And all the time he's thinking, Jesus is alive, but I think I'm finished. And we know the story when Jesus was there cooking the fish and Peter came and he went to walk with Peter. 3 times he let Jesus down and 3 times Jesus said, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? And then Peter said, you know that I love you. And the Lord knew that Peter was going to be instrumental in the new church a few weeks later. And he had to forgive him from what happened in the past, all the failures and disappointments. And he released him into what he had for the future. And we see just a few weeks later, Peter's the one preached and 3,000 people came to know Christ. He's one of the pillars, the rocks of the church. And incredible. If he'd lived in his disappointment and lived in his mistakes, he would have never been the man that God wanted him to be, you know, and he died upside down in a cross. But he was the one that walked on water. He's the one that saw mighty miracles. He's the one that helped establish the church all across the world. But if he looked back and remembered all those mistakes, he would have never done it. If he looked in the rear view mirror, he would have never been the man that God wanted him to be. You know, in every one of our lives, we've made mistakes. Anybody here not made a mistake? You're a liar. call no man a liar. That's what my mom used to tell me. No, it's true. Every one of us has made mistakes. Every one of us has made wrong choices. Every one of us has messed up. Every one of us has been disappointed by people. Disappointed by churches even. Disappointed by friends and family. Or we've disappointed other people. That's almost worse. That's harder. We feel we've disappointed somebody or disappointed the church or whatever it may be. And what we do is we just bury our head in the sand. We just begin to attend church, but we say, God, I know you can't use me because I've disappointed you. I've disappointed other people. I'm hurt, Lord, because of how I'm feeling. If only I hadn't done that. If only I hadn't said that. If only I hadn't gone. And we can live in the past and it will stop us from reaching our future in God. Often the only person that disqualifies us from serving God and living for Jesus is us. We can't let go of our mistakes and disappointments. We're meant to learn from our mistakes. We're not meant to die because of our mistakes. And so I want to encourage you, you know, sometimes our disappointments and moments of failure, we allow it to define us. I remember a guy at Bible college, his name was Steve, and he got up and he gave his testimony, and this guy was confident. This guy was a good preacher. And then he told us a story. When he was 14 years old, he was a really good swimmer. He went to the swimming event in his school. All his family were there. All the teachers were there. You know, it was just fantastic. It was a big, big thing, big meet. And he said that they're all lined up, ready to go. And he heard the ready, steady, poof. And he jumped and he swam. He heard people shout. He swam to the other end and he's halfway along back. And then he realized people are laughing. What are they laughing at? And then he realized there's nobody around him. And he stood up in the pool, took his goggles off and realized it was a false start. And for like a minute and a half, he'd been swimming. And first of all, people were cheering and then they were laughing and he could see. He just got out of the pool, got dressed and went home. And he says for years, for the next 5-6 years, he became like a recluse. He was so disappointed. He couldn't believe what he'd done. He couldn't believe everybody laughing at him. He couldn't believe how he let down his family. And you know, it really defined him. Took away his confidence. And he said that one time he went to this conference and God said, look, I want to take away that memory and give you a new start. And he got down on his knees and God began to speak into his life. And here he was in Bible college serving the Lord and wanted to serve the Lord with all of his heart. But you know what? For all those years, that defined him. And maybe there's things in your life that's defined you. You look back at disappointments. You look back at things you've said. You look back at situations where you're so hurt. Don't look back and allow the disappointments and the hurts and the mistakes stop you from being the man and woman God wants you to be. My last point, don't look back at what you've done. You know, looking back isn't always negative. It's actually quite a positive thing. Imagine Paul, here he is. We know the story. He was brought up a Jew of Jew, a Pharisee of Pharisees, incredible man in the law. And then he has an encounter with Jesus. He'd been putting Christians in jail and he saw Stephen being stoned. He held the jackets at that time. And we see he's got radical transformation and for nobody believed him. Not even the apostles believed that he could have such a radical conversion. And so he ends up for 9 years, you know, back in his hometown. And then Barnabas goes for him and Barnabas brings him back to Antioch. They begin to pray and God says, I've called you, Paul and Barnabas, to start new churches all across the world. And so he goes out and for year after year, he's planting new churches, raising up leadership, incredible miracles, signs, wonders, incredible man of God, writes letters that we still love today. Just an incredible life. He was stoned. He was beaten. He was abused. He was thrown in jail. He was laughed at. He was jeered at. He was spat at. Everything. He says, my body is a scarred for the gospel. And here he is, in his last few years, the last year of his life, he's writing to the church in Philippi that he'd started. And this is what he said. He's talking about, you know, reaching the goal. He's talking about reaching out to God. He says, I press on to possess that perfection of what Christ Jesus first possessed me. No, dear brothers and sisters, I haven't achieved it, but I focus on this one thing. Forgetting the past, looking forward to that lies ahead, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. I forget what is behind and I press on. What, Paul? You're going to forget what's behind? All the churches you've started? All the miracles you've seen? All the people you've raised up? You know, the incredible ministry you've had? I forget it right now. I forget all those things. I forget the good and the bad. I forget all the stonings. I forget all the pain. I forget all the broken bones. I forget the shipwreck. I forget everything. I forget everything is behind. And now I press on to what God has for me right now. Wow. Some of you need to realize, forget what's behind. Whether it be good or bad. Situations that are great or situations that make you cry. Let's forget what's behind. I look at my life, there is a mixture of incredible things. You know, going to Edinburgh, going to Bible college, going to Edinburgh, going to Africa, going to Whitburn, going to Philippines, coming to Wales. So many incredible people I've met. So many miracles we've seen. So many people saved. So many churches planted. But along with that, there's so many times that you've been betrayed, so many times that people let you down, so many times people walked away, so many times that people said things, you know, and there's a mixture of everything. But I'm just saying to myself, Mark, as I come to the end of 2020, let's forget what's behind. Let's forget 2020. Let's forget what's behind and press on to what God has for me right now. What's behind you? It's time to let it go. Especially if you have to forgive. Forgive and forget and move on. Don't allow those things to stop you from reaching your potential. Don't rest on your laurels. Don't feel it's all over. Don't feel you've done your bit and that's it. God can use you. Everybody, breathe in. Right now, breathe in. 1, 2, 3. Breathe out. If you can breathe in and breathe out, God can use you. God can use you. If you've got breath in your body, God can use you. Caleb said, give me this mountain. I'm 80 years old, but I'm just as strong as I was when I was 40. Give me this mountain. Don't look back and see what you've done, but say, God, what do you want me to do? Remember yesterday's, but don't live there. Glean memories, but don't always live in the past. Don't look back. To the end of my message, I just saw this incredible little clip. I think in 1956, there's five young American men who had a burden for a tribe in Ecuador. And one of them was called Jim Elliot. We all know Jim Elliot, but there was other men as well, just in the prime with wives and kids. And we know they went there and, you know, they were massacred on the beach. And this little video just is incredible. I just find it so moving when I watched it. This is one of the sons of those missionaries talking about how he decided not to look back, but to look forward. And the incredible thing is that many of these women who lost their husbands, whose kids lost their fathers, God called them back to that exact place. You watch this video and you will be absolutely blessed. So guys, I just want to encourage you. Don't look back at what you had. Don't look back and make excuses. Don't look back and remember your mistakes and disappointments. Don't look back at all you've done in the past. But say, God, today, I'm going to worship you and serve you. Enjoy this little video and I'm telling you, you're going to be blessed.
My dad was killed when I was just a little boy, and it was with four of his friends, and it was a really violent killing. And people ask me all the time, you know, how I could forgive the people that killed my dad, including Grandfather Minkai, who I think was the one who finally did kill my dad. But, you know, I'm sure that they don't understand the perspective from which I saw it all. My dad and his four friends, Roger, Pete, Ed, and Jim, knew that they were risking their lives to try to contact this violent group that had never had friendly contact with the outside world. And then when it came right down to them being attacked, they had guns and they could have defended themselves, but they preferred to die rather than kill, even in self-defense. My aunt was living with a young girl from the Waodani tribe who had fled. My mom went on praying for the Waodani, and then Aunt Rachel went back in to live with these people for the very first time as outsiders. And my aunt knew that there was a risk, and I knew that there was a risk that she would be killed too. Well, by the time a year, year and a half later, when I got to go in and live with Aunt Rachel with these people who'd killed my dad, that isn't the way I saw them at all. I saw them as being the most special people in the whole world. I mean, why else would my dad have been willing to die for them, my mom go on praying for them, and my aunt risk her life for them? People think it's so amazing that I would forgive Ming Kai, but you know, in their culture, because he killed my family, it was my right and my responsibility when I grew up to kill him or his family. But when I went in to live in the jungles, I was just, eight or nine. And I didn't have any of the skills that I needed to live in the jungles. And Ming Kai, I went to my Aunt Rachel, and he said, "What's wrong with Steve?" They call me Baba down there. "What's wrong with Baba? He doesn't know how to make poison for his darts, he can't make darts, he doesn't know how to use a blowgun, he can't track animals." He said, "He doesn't know anything." He said, "Who's going to teach him how to live?" And my aunt said, "You having speared his father, who do you say should teach him to live?" And he came back and he said, "Me having speared his father, now I say I myself will teach him to live." But you know, in doing that, because he had started walking a new trail, he had no idea. I was just a little boy. He had no idea whether I was going to walk God's trail or whether I would use the skills that he was teaching me to come back and kill him. But he forgave me what he assumed I would grow up to do because he had begun walking this new trail. So really, if you look at it in the reality in which it took place, the forgiveness that he was willing to believe that I had given up my vendetta against him and then gave me the skills that I would need to carry it out if I didn't give it up, his was maybe the greater forgiveness than mine. When I was a teenager, my sister decided that she wanted to be baptized, and my mom said, "Since you don't have a father of your own who's living, why don't you choose somebody who's had a positive spiritual impact in your life, and I'll ask him to baptize you." Well, Kathy immediately chose Kimo, one of the men who had killed my dad and Roger and Pete and Ed and Jim. And I thought, you know, look at these men here, Kimo and Dewey and Ming Kai. They're the same men who were here at this very place and killed my dad. And now here they are. They're spiritual leaders in our lives. And I realized if we let God write the story, he doesn't always promise that all the chapters will be easy, but he does promise that in the last chapter, he will make sense of all the other things that have happened in our life, even though some of them are terribly painful. And I'm very, very thankful that he has. We have become, as Grandfather says, we have become like just one family, because we all have the same father. Minkai winin yeri waurani nangi. A long time ago, my grandfathers, they were very angry. They would die, they would die. They were angry and they were killing each other. Pinte is the word for angry or furious. We would go and spear other people in our tribe, and they would come and spear us. It was just like that. Now we're not being angry. He said, now some of us who were enemies, who were hating and furious with each other, now we've become like one Okabo, like one head, like one family. That's what I have to say. Do you understand me?
Okay.
People have been able, in this story, to identify with my loss. But what they can't seem to identify with is how I and my family, how we experienced gain. You know, when my dad was killed and I was a little boy, I can still remember that sense of anguish, disenfranchisement. I mean, my whole little boy universe revolved around my dad. I wanted to grow up and be just like him. He was my hero. When my mom told me that he was never coming back, I mean, it shattered my whole world. I thought there was nothing left to live for. But you know what? Just a short while ago, when Christmas was coming, and grandfather came up to our house, I saw him with my three of my granddaughters. He was holding one who was asleep in his arms, and the other two were draped over his shoulders. And that night, as Jenny and I were going to bed, grandfather had already gone to sleep, and Jenny said, "Just want to go in and kiss him once more, don't you?" And you know, then I realized that same yearning that I had for my father, I now feel for Grandfather Minkai, the man who killed him. That's something that doesn't happen in fiction. That can only happen in true life.
How many of you are blown away with that video? Oh, I was just so touched when he said that the very place that his dad lost his life was a place where he was baptized by the man who killed his dad. You know, it'd be so easy for these ladies in particular to look back and just say, "I don't want to go near Ecuador in my life. I don't want to go back to that place." But each one of them, God was dealing with them. Will you still pray for them? Will you still pray for them? And that led to, will you go and reach them with the gospel? Will you continue and finish the work that your husband started, who gave their lives for that cause? I just think that's one of the most incredible stories. And I just want it to become just a real reality in our lives. Let's not look back. Let's not look back, but let's look ahead. Let's live for the Lord today, and let's plan for amazing things tomorrow. Don't look back, but look up and look ahead. To end our service today, Martin Chalk's going to sing a song, "Be Thou My Vision." You know, in everything that we do these next few months and years, let's look to Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. Let's look to him, all eyes on Jesus. Not on the pandemic, not on what's happening around us. It's good to see what's happening, but let's fix our eyes on Jesus and let him become our vision. So Martin's going to sing this beautiful song. And then after that, I'm really going to encourage you again to join us for Zoom. And I just pray that God's spoken to you today. We've had some amazing things happen today. And I pray God's spoken to you and that you won't be somebody that looks behind, but looks forward and looks ahead and say, "God, what have you got for me?" God bless you all. Enjoy this song and I'll see you in Zoom. Bye.
Be thou my